12, I'm going to begin reading at verse 1. Paul says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, so that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Amen. One of the best known passages in the book of Romans, as the Apostle Paul encourages us to present ourselves to God and live a godly life. The title of my message today is Living a Transformed Life. Living a Transformed Life. Let's pray and let's invite the Father's blessing upon us as we look into his word together. Will you pray with me? Father, we come into your presence again in Jesus' name, and we thank you so much for the gift of your word. It's truly the lamp for our feet and the light for our pathway. Jesus said that the word of God is like seed. So, Father, we give you our hearts right now. Would you touch our hearts? Let our hearts be good soil that can bear fruit from the seed of the word of God. Lord Jesus, you said that the words you speak to us, they are spirit and they are life. So would you send your spirit now to minister life to us today from the scriptures? If you agree with that, would you say amen and amen? Well, last week, Pastor Glenn was sharing with us from Romans 11 all about making other people jealous. You know, the quality of our lives and the power of Christ inside our lives is something that should make people jealous. Jealous to become a part of the family of God. The forgiveness, the freedom that we have in Christ, and the favor of God that's resting upon our lives should make Christian living supremely attractive to people. And as we walk in humility, Pastor shared how we can win many people to him. And now as we move into chapter 12, we've come to a very pivotal turning point in the book of Romans. From chapter 1 all the way up through chapter 11, Paul has been explaining and defending the gospel. Now we might say that we have reached the ethical section of the letter. In other words, we've reached the part of the letter that tells us how to live as believers. Looking at Romans quickly, we could say that the first part is about what we believe, and the second part of Romans is about how we should live. Paul has spent the entire letter up till now explaining how God has worked in Christ to save us by his grace. Now he's going to tell us how to walk out our faith in this world. But we shouldn't think that everything we are going to see in the last chapters of Romans is just simply Paul giving us a new set of commandments. You see, the gospel is about grace, every bit of it. We were saved by grace, and now we also live out our Christian faith by grace, by God's enabling every day. You remember with me that all the way back in chapter 1, Paul said what? He said, I am not ashamed of the gospel. Why? He said he was not ashamed because the gospel is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. But that doesn't just mean the power to be saved when we first come to Christ. The good news of the gospel also means that God will give you the power to live it out and walk faithfully with the Lord. So let's not see chapter 12 and what follows as something that's totally different from the first 11 chapters. Those first 11 chapters speak about God's power to save us, and the chapters we're moving in now as we start to finish Romans are calling me to trust in the power of that same God to help me live a life that will bring pleasure to his heart. So now that we have God's power, Paul will be showing us in the last few chapters how to serve. In the brief couple of verses that we read today, Paul's telling us how to serve God. And as we keep moving toward the end of the letter, he's going to tell us how to serve each other, how to serve people through the gifts of the Holy Spirit, how we relate as Christians to our government, among other things. In chapter 12, the Holy Spirit shows us how we can start to live for God and enjoy God's blessings. The Spirit's letting me know that we can do that by looking back and calling to mind all of the beautiful truths that we've been learning about in the first 11 chapters. And this is how Paul begins his appeal here to the believers. In verse 1, he says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God. Everybody say that word, mercies. Why is Paul trying to motivate them in this way? Why is he appealing to them by the mercies of God? And what does that mean? In the previous chapter, we saw Pastor Glenn was sharing with us how mercy had come to the Gentiles because the Jewish people had stumbled at the message of Christ. So some have suggested that maybe those are the mercies that Paul's speaking about. But I think it's something much bigger than that. Paul is appealing to us to live for God because of all the mercies that he's been talking about in Romans, starting in chapter 1 and running all the way up to this point. The Holy Spirit wants us to see that everything that we have been reading in Romans from the very beginning is simply God showing you about all of his mercies in your life. Are you glad for the mercies of God in your life? So Paul says, I am pleading with you to live a godly life, and I want to motivate you to do it by asking you to look at all the mercies of God. Look back at everything that God has done in Christ to save you and forgive you and set you free. He says, I want you to live for God out of a sense of gratitude for the great salvation that is yours in Christ. A sense of gratitude that the Son of God would leave his heaven and take on flesh and die for you when you were far away from the presence of God. Are you grateful for that this morning? He says, I want you to live for God out of a sense of gratitude for the fact that he says in Romans 8, he's making all things to work together for your good. The Holy Spirit wants us to live out of a sense of gratitude that God has destined us to be glorified together with Christ. Jesus, of course, said it so simply and beautifully as he said everything. Jesus said, he who has been forgiven much, what? Loves much. And so Paul said, I urge you to do these things because of the mercies that a loving Father has extended to you. How can we show our gratitude to the Father for all his mercies and start to live a transformed life for him? I see three keys here to doing that in Romans 12, and I want to share them with you. The first one is this: offer yourself to God as a living sacrifice. Offer yourself to God as a living sacrifice. Paul says, I appeal to you by the mercies of God to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. What on earth is a living sacrifice? This is a phrase that has intrigued people for centuries. Of course, nowadays, the very concept of sacrifices is foreign to us. But people in the ancient world would have found the idea of a living sacrifice to be even more strange. See, back in chapter 9, Paul explained to us how God had given the Jewish people the temple worship with all of its various rituals. And you know that under the law of Moses, the Jews offered different animals and they offered the produce of their fields to God. But now that Christ has come to be the final sacrifice for sin, we as Christians, we make no more sacrifices of animals or grains to God. If that's the case, then what sacrifices do we make? Paul shows us here that the acceptable sacrifice we make as Christians is the sacrifice of ourselves, giving ourselves completely to God. It's not a sacrifice to take away sins because Christ has already done that by his blood. And it's not a sacrifice that results in our death, but it's the giving of ourselves to him willingly out of gratitude and out of love. It's our entire life of devotion, our life of consecration to God. And in fact, the Greek language expresses that better than English does, because Paul was really saying in Greek, keep on presenting yourself to God as a living sacrifice. How many of you know that that's true, that that's an everyday thing? Keep on presenting yourself to Him. How do we do that? How do we present ourselves to God in a way that's holy and acceptable? I think we can get some insight into that by looking back at those sacrifices of the Old Covenant. First, being a living sacrifice means that we must consciously give ourselves to God as an act of our will. You may remember that worshipers at the temple had to physically bring their sacrifices to the Lord. Sometimes that involved a little bit of effort. It might have involved some travel. People had to be very deliberate about bringing sacrifices to God. You and I must do the same, not in that same sense, but we must make a deliberate choice to consecrate ourselves to the Lord and be willing to offer our lives to Him as a voluntary decision. It starts when you and I say, Lord, I choose to give myself to You. That's the beginning of being a living sacrifice. Second, being a living sacrifice means that we recognize the lordship of Christ. To truly offer our lives to God, we need to realize that He has a claim upon us, a claim that's greater even than the claim we have ourselves upon our own lives. In the Old Testament, God had a claim upon His worshipers and a claim upon their offerings. They were obligated to bring Him these animal sacrifices and the produce of their fields. And as believers in Christ, how many of you know that God has a claim upon us as well? You and I were bought with a price that cannot be properly valued or estimated, the price of the blood of His Son. And so in response, we recognize His sovereignty over us. We acknowledge how good and how kind He's been to us. And so because of that, we're willing to serve Him with gratitude by giving Him our very lives. As a living sacrifice, I acknowledge that I belong to Him. Third, being a living sacrifice means I give up the right to do it my way, giving myself without reservation. I like to call this the Frank Sinatra doctrine. I give up the right to do it my way. Now, I'm not trying to be cute by saying it this way, but although bringing a sacrifice can be expensive, being the sacrifice costs even more. I think you would all agree with me today that you would rather bring a sacrifice than be a sacrifice. Think back with me again to those animals that were offered in the temple. They had no rights except the right to be offered up to God, if you will. And the Holy Spirit is letting me know here that if I am a living sacrifice, then there will be times that I am not so comfortable. You know, God might do some things on occasion without consulting me first. Imagine that. In church, there will be times when I have to trust God in the dark and have faith that His plan is still good despite what I'm seeing, and have faith that there's something better that is on the way from God. Amen. Jesus held on and He kept trusting the Father even on the cross, because the Bible says He knew there was going to be joy on the other side of that terrible experience. And it's the same with you and me. Being a living sacrifice means that I give myself to Him without reservation, even if it should mean the death of some things that I cherish, and I can't always do it my way. And fourth, being a living sacrifice means that we give ourselves to Him completely. We know that when a sacrifice was made to God in the temple, it was offered fully. Nothing was left over. There was no part of that animal that was not given to God. I never read in the Bible that there was such a thing as a 50% sacrifice or even a 90% sacrifice. I never read anywhere in the scripture that a man brought a lamb to the priest and said, "Could you just take off one leg today?" That was a joke. You'll get that later. And in the same way, being a living sacrifice means we're willing to give ourselves over completely to Him. Do we always succeed in that? No. But the closer we draw to Him, the more we will also desire to fully please Him, as the scripture says. Be willing to give God every part of your life as a living sacrifice. Have a hunger for holiness, a desire to please Him out of love and gratitude. Paul says that we can be living sacrifices that are holy, and this is the kind of acceptable living that brings pleasure to God's heart. Well, you may be saying, Pastor Nick, look, I know myself pretty well, and I'm not good enough to live like that. Well, no, you can't, at least not in your own strength. But my Bible says that God told us it's not by might, and it's not by power, but it's by my Spirit, says the Lord. And it's in the very act of presenting yourself to God, being willing to offer yourself to Him, that His grace and His power and His strength will start to flow out to you, and He will start to help you to live for Him as soon as you start to offer yourself to Him first. Here's a really good word for somebody as we step into 2017. Stop trying to be strong for Christ and be strong in Christ. The Bible says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Let's present ourselves to Him as living sacrifices, and He will respond and empower us. My grace, Jesus said, is sufficient for you because my strength is made perfect or is made complete in our what? In our weakness. Can we get deep here for a minute? I think we already are a little deep. But can we get deep? I hope you had some. Did you have some protein this morning? I hope so. The cafeteria is not up and running, so I hope you had some protein today. But listen, Paul says that offering yourself to God is our spiritual worship. Now listen, church, this is a really difficult phrase to translate out of Greek and into English. Some Bibles, you know, if you grew up reading the old King James Bible, you know that some Bibles translate into English by saying that offering yourself to God is your reasonable service. And what Paul was telling the believers was that giving yourself to God, offering yourself to Him, is the rational way to serve God. And that word translated as spiritual or reasonable or rational, it's a Greek word, logikos. And just what it looks like, that word is where you and I get our English word logical from. Paul is telling us that offering yourself to God just makes sense. It's the rational thing. It's the smart thing to do. I like to say it this way. When we think about the mercies of God, then offering ourselves to God out of gratitude is the least we can do. Amen. How could I ever repay Jesus Christ for the shedding of His blood? Reasonable worship also means that this is the way that we as rational creatures should be giving God, because we have an understanding of how to worship Him. There is a famous philosopher who lived at the time of Paul or a little bit after, and he used this word logikos in just that way. He said, if I were a nightingale, I would sing as a nightingale. If I were a swan, I would sing like a swan. But because I'm a rational being, therefore, I should be singing hymns of praise to God. And you and I are God's highest creation, made in His image. And giving ourselves to Him is the way that we should be worshiping Him. I think Paul's looking back all the way to Romans chapter 1. You remember with us in Romans chapter 1, Paul was talking about people who, even though they were made in the image of God, what happened to them? They ended up worshiping and serving created things instead of serving the Creator, even though they were made in the image of the Creator. But listen, you and I, when we offer ourselves to God as a living sacrifice, then we are finally worshiping Him in spirit and truth, and we are finally worshiping Him in the way that God always wanted mankind to worship Him. So He says, it's your reasonable service of worship. It just makes sense, and it's true worship that will transform you when you place your life into His hands. How can we show our gratitude to the Father and lead a transformed life? The first key is to offer yourself to Him as a living sacrifice. The second key is this: don't be conformed to this world. Paul says in verse 2, you like that? He's not conforming, right? Paul says in verse 2, do not be conformed to this world. What does it mean to be conformed to the world? First, we need to understand that in the Bible, the expression "the world" doesn't mean planet Earth. The Bible says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Paul is not saying that the earth itself is an evil place. What he means is the world system. So the Bible warns you against the systems that are operating in this world, because they are systems that are opposed to God. And guess what? They are opposed to you also. That's why the Apostle John said in his first letter, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Because everything that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away with its desires, but whoever does the will of God remains forever. So what's Paul telling us by saying don't be conformed to the world? And how do we keep from being conformed to the world system? Well, first, don't value the things that the world values. Don't set your hopes on the things that the world is trusting in. Don't set your heart, don't set your affections on the things that the world loves. Don't listen to the voice of the world that wants to pull your heart away from God and from devotion to Him, so that we become cold in our hearts. When you see those warning signs inside your heart, then you can know that you're starting to be conformed to this world and to its thinking. This world is passing away, John said, along with its deceptive desires. And when the Bible writers say the world, they're really using the Greek word that means age, A-G-E. That emphasizes to us the temporary nature of the current system. It is rapidly, the Bible says, passing away. The Bible tells us that Satan is the god of this world, or the god of this age, but his kingdom is passing away. So church, please don't waste your life by sowing your life into a world system that is quickly fading away. Amen. Don't devote your strength, your youth, your energy to an age that has set itself against God, and that will soon be replaced by a new age that will be headed up by Jesus Christ Himself personally. Paul says, don't be conformed to this age and to the way things work in this age. Decide that you will live according to the kingdom of God, the kingdom that God has already introduced into this world, the kingdom that's living inside of you now, the kingdom that one day is going to be completely manifested and blow this current age away like dust in the wind. Paul says in Galatians that Jesus gave Himself for our sins. Why? So that He might deliver us from this present evil age. So let me ask you the question today. If Jesus came to save us from this present evil age, why would we want to keep conforming to it? Word conform is an interesting word. It means to fashion something, or to be fashioned into something, like a pattern or a mold. The way Paul phrases it here is a little ambiguous. And I want you to get this, because it's so important. What Paul said here can literally mean that you are being shaped. Or listen, it can also suggest that you are allowing yourself to be shaped. If we were saying this in modern English, we might say it like this: the world wants to keep squeezing you into its mold. So don't cooperate it. Don't let the world squeeze you into its mold. Church, don't conform to the world's behavior and to its deceptive pleasures. Don't conform to the world's ways of thinking and its speech. Don't conform to the world's way of doing business. Say, well, everybody does it that way. Yes, but you don't have to. Don't conform to this world's irreverence for God. Don't trade your precious birthright for something that is unfulfilling and temporary. Instead, pursue the Lord. In contrast to this age that is unfulfilling and temporary, guess what? My Bible says that in his presence there is fullness of joy. And at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore, not temporarily. Praise God. How can we show our gratitude to God and begin to live a transformed life? First, offer yourself to him as a living sacrifice. Second, don't be conformed to this world. And finally this, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Paul says in verse 2, be transformed by the renewal of your mind, so that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. What is this transformation? Well, this is a Greek word that you've heard before. It's the word metamorphosis. Metamorphosis. That means that a change has taken place. And it's not just any change, but it's a change that has given you a new form, a new shape or appearance. Do you remember when we were little kids, we learned in school how caterpillars undergo metamorphosis and they change into butterflies? And when you experience a metamorphosis, you are still you, and yet you've been changed. Do you know in the New Testament, there's only one person who was described as having had a metamorphosis. And you think it's easy to get up here and say metamorphosis 9 times? It's really not. But there's only one person who was described as having a metamorphosis, and in fact, it was Jesus. We read in Mark chapter 9 that one day Jesus led his disciples up a high mountain, and the Bible said he was transfigured. Everybody say that, transfigured. He was transfigured before their eyes, and his clothes became radiant, intensely white, whiter than anybody could launder them. He was still Jesus, and they still could recognize him, but he had been transformed. Now, I'm not suggesting that you're going to be transfigured like Jesus was, although if you are, please post it on YouTube because I really would love to see that. But listen, here's the point. You can experience a change in your life that will transform you into a different person. Paul says it happens by the renewing of our mind. Now, that word literally means a renovation. It's like a house being renovated. It's the same house, but you have put it in a much better condition, and now it's worth a lot more than it used to be. But here's the trick. It's something that we have to allow to happen. It's something we have to let God do within us. Paul didn't say transform yourself. He didn't say change yourself. He said be transformed. And as we cooperate with God in the renewing of our mind, then we will see that over weeks and over months and over some years, we're being transformed. We are no longer the same. How do we experience that renewal? And is there a way that we could kickstart that metamorphosis? Well, first and foremost, we do it through the Word of God. The Word of God is perhaps the greatest help that God has given us by which to renew our minds. Now, let's think about this for a moment. When we first come to faith in Christ, I think you would agree with me that our minds only know how to think the way they have always thought. You thought I was going to say thinked there for a minute, right? Yes, I may be saved when I come to Christ, but that doesn't mean that I know all about Christian living. When we come to Christ, God is very kind and gracious to give us the Holy Spirit, but I also need the Word of God to teach me how to live and to teach me how to think in a godly way. This is good right here. Listen, I need to feed upon the Word of God. Peter said that like newborn babies, we should desire what he called the pure milk of the Word of God so that we can grow. What happens when you and I begin to feed upon the Word of God? Well, for one thing, we begin to grow in our faith, because the Bible says that faith comes by hearing. Hearing what? The Word of God. The Holy Spirit will begin to guide you, because the Bible says the entering in of God's Word gives you light. His Word is a light for our pathway. It shows me the way to go when I don't know where to walk. When I feed upon the Word, I begin to walk in a greater peace. Anxiety starts to dissipate out of my life, because the Bible tells me that those who love His law experience great peace. How many of you also know that the Word of God brings us purity when we hide it in our heart? Jesus said the Word of God is what sanctifies us. And the Word of God encourages me. We sang about it this morning. All of His promises are yes and amen. And if that doesn't encourage you, you just can't be. It gives me power over temptation. John Bunyan was the author of the classic Christian book, Pilgrim's Progress. And John Bunyan said it this way. He said, sin will keep you from this book, or this book will keep you from sin. There's a choice in that. The scriptures also help me to pray, and they help me to pray well. Ephesians 6 talks about the sword of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit brings God's word to your mind, and He helps you to pray powerful prayers that get you the victory and that outsmart the devil. The Bible gives me wisdom. David said in Psalm 119, I have more understanding than all of my teachers because I'm always thinking about your laws. And the Word of God establishes me and makes me strong. Praise God. It leads me into prosperity when I do it, and godly success. That's why God told Joshua, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate upon it day and night in order that you may be careful to observe everything that is written inside it, because then you will make your way prosperous. And then God said, you will have good success. God helps us to renew our mind through His powerful word. He also helps us to renew our minds as we worship Him. See, the more we worship God, the more we seek His face, the more you and I will desire to become like Jesus. There's a transformation that takes place there. Just like the old song says, the things of earth will become strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. When we worship, we begin to get heaven's perspective on things, not the perspective of this world. And the more we worship Him, therefore, the more we no longer want to be conformed to this world. We no longer want to be as attached to it as we might have been. If you were with us when we looked at 2 Corinthians, then you remember Paul says there that all of us, with an unveiled face, we are beholding the glory of the Lord. And as we do, we are being what? We are being changed. We are being transformed. It's the same word, metamorphosis. We are being transformed into the same image as God by His Spirit is taking us from one degree of glory to another degree of glory. There is a change that comes over your life when you seek God in worship and prayer, and when you seek Him in His word. David said the same thing back in Psalm 34. He said, God's people looked to Him and they were made radiant. That will happen to you too. As you keep looking to His presence, you will become radiant. That means that His glory will start to pervade more and more areas of your life. Church, I have to move on from this, but I want to let you know that over these next few weeks, we're going to keep digging into this issue so that we can get God's help. Next week, Pastor Glenn's going to be back in the pulpit, and we're going to start a special sermon series called Transformed, renew your mind in Christ. It's on our heart this year to help people renew their minds through the Word of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. And we've given you a little card. It's an invitation card inside your bulletin today. And you could use that to remind yourself or maybe to invite a friend out. How many of you know, serious question on this, how many of you know somebody who has made a mess of their lives or who hasn't achieved what they could have achieved in life because of poor decision making or poor thinking? Amen. Make sure that you're with us over these next few weeks as we share about the difference it can make when you have a mind that's been transformed by Christ. We want to help you to think better this year so that you can live better. And as somebody once said, that's good preaching right there. So, worship team, you can come back, please, and help us. Amen. Church, as we close this morning, I want to let you know that God has a great purpose for us in renovating our minds. When we learn to think according to God's word, and when we analyze the situations that we're facing with God's wisdom, something happens. How many of you are facing something during this week that's coming up at work or in your family that needs God's wisdom? Amen. How many of you are upset with me because I made you think about it and you didn't want to think about it till tomorrow? Amen. But listen, when we begin to analyze those situations with God's wisdom, something will happen. God lets you see a solution that you couldn't see before. God will teach you how to prosper. God will show you how to set things in order in your life that maybe have been disorganized or chaotic. Paul says in verse 2, be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that by testing you can discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. You see, the Bible is completely perfect, amen? But it's not designed to cover every situation in your life. The Bible doesn't tell me if I should marry a certain person. The Bible doesn't tell me if I should take that job or if I should go back to school. The Bible was not designed to do that for you. See, church, God wants us to have a renewed mind, and He wants you to have a heart that can hear His living voice so that we can discern the will of God, like Paul says. When our mind is renewed, then it's easier for us to cut through the noise and cut through all of the competing voices that are coming at you every day with all of their advice and sometimes causing you confusion. In Hebrews chapter 4, we read that the Word of God is alive and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, and it pierces all the way to the dividing place between your soul and your spirit, of joints and marrow, and it discerns the thoughts and it discerns the intentions of your heart. When your mind is renewed, see, you can get a leading from God. We can get wisdom from God, and we can know that we're doing God's will and not the desires of our own souls or the thoughts of our own hearts, which can sometimes mislead us. Paul tells us that with a renewed mind, we can discern His will, and we can start to walk in what's good. We can start to walk in what God finds acceptable. We can start to walk in things that God will find commendable. Church, what a beautiful quality of life that God is offering to His sons and His daughters. His grace saves us, and it also empowers us to live a life that is satisfying in every way. Because we're grateful for His mercies, this year, let's offer ourselves to Him as living sacrifices. Because we love Him, let's refuse to be conformed to this world anymore. This year, let's be transformed by the renewing of our minds so that we can do God's will and so that we can bring pleasure to God's heart. Come on, would you stand together with me? Let's give Jesus a hand of praise in His place.